Okay, thank you. So the first slide is a little bit scary. What it's supposed to mean is that the brain is a complicated network of neurons, too many of those, if you ask me. And so this is a very scary slide, but that's what it is from neuroscientist perspective. From perspective of a mathematician, it's a lot less scary, of course. So in some simplified version of the previous slide, you can think of this as a directed graph where each directed edge has a weight, and each node is an actual neuron, and it has a number attached to it, which people often call firing rate. So that's, of course, oversimplification, but so that's a time-dependent rate. So this is what your neurons actually do. And as you can imagine from this graph, there are two kinds of data attached to this graph, right? One is the actual synaptic weights, which are what your memory is made of, by the way, in the structure of your brain. And the other is Xi being this variable. So this is just a placeholder to say that's a complicated weighted graph. And this is how this activity actually looks like. So this x-axis is time, and y-axis is different neurons. And like I said, this is oversimplification. So in reality, it's actually discrete events that are called spikes. So what is known about these things? So a lot more known about activity than connectivity. So what is known is your global connectivity in your brain, of course, how different parts talk to each other. What is not known is local connectivity inside each area of your brain, because this is actually very difficult to capture. So, but activity you can record by sticking electrodes and in threads, of course, and measuring the activity, or on more global level using fMRI approaches, which is legal in humans. Okay, so the goal of this talk is to convince you that it's even in theory possible to detect structure in neural activity or connectivity if such data is available. Okay, first of all, I have to explain what I mean by structure. So one possibility is random. And of course, you think to yourself, oh, wait a second, I know my brain is not random. I can think for one. But this is an interesting result, relatively recent. What people did was measuring, should I ignore it? Okay. So what people actually measured was the first feedforward layer in fly olfactory system. This is the actual matrix, which took a couple of years to measure. And the gist of this paper, which I'm not going to explain in full detail, is that it's as good as random. So the primary olfactory system of a fly, which clearly does something for a fly, is random. At least people try to find a lot of structure and failed. Well, actually, random networks can also do quite a few interesting things.
Sorry, what are the x and the y coordinates?
This is this network is bipartite graph. So each pixel here is an edge in bipartite graph. This is, say, left, this is right in bipartite graph. So imagine bipartite graph, right? So for each edge, I put a pixel, right? People, this is the measurement, what people managed to measure. Okay, the rest of...
You're just correlating signals at two different spots.
It's not signals. People actually measured connectivity. It was very, quite a technical feat from experimental neuroscience perspective. But my talk is not about this. This is just an example. Okay, so fine. So we now, at least if we believe the paper I just showcased, we believe that in some cases, random actually makes sense. Even though I'm still stunned that fly's olfactory system is pseudo-random. But okay, I have to explain now what I mean by non-random, and there'll be two possibilities, spatially structured, which I'm gonna say in a second, and something else which I'm gonna explain much later. So spatially structured networks. So what do I mean by those? Well, first imagine this situation where each neuron has an actual position in some feature space, let's say some metric space. And whenever there is a synapse that happens between two neurons, then the strength of the synaptic connection, this Wij, is some function of the distance in this feature space plus something at dub noise, right? the import, and also this function is assumed to be monotonic. That's important. Otherwise, this formula is meaningless. All right, and these things are hypothesized to be responsible for quite a few functions people observe using electrophysiology in the brain, many properties of visual system in primates and in other systems in rodents and so forth. So, okay, but this is, ironically, this is still a hypothesis. The reason why it's a hypothesis, it's very hard to measure this matrix in a local circuit. Okay, so let me start switching gears a little bit. So why is it not a trivial affair? Why can't we just, if somebody gave us this matrix, why can't we just immediately say, okay, this comes from this spatial organization? What's wrong with this? So normally the data comes as this matrix Cij, which is approximately a function of some truly structured variables. You can think of this Aij, say, distance in your matrix space. But this f is unknown. There is no way to know this f. The only thing we know about f, it's monotone. Okay? So, all right. What can we say about this? Let's see what is invariant on monotone transformation. So, of course, monotone transformations, this is just one-dimensional thing, so they form a group. So what is not invariant is the spectrum, of course. So if you try to compute a spectrum of this matrix, so this is the very standard thing. This is Wigner semicircle law. So assume matrix is symmetric, and the entries are IID and normally distributed. This is standard Wigner semicircle law. If you apply nonlinearity, and if you are, I don't know, first year graduate student in physics, you may make a lot of deal out of this nice eigenvalues that stand out, but that's purely an artifact of applying nonlinearity. Even though Wigner's semicircle law, I mean, the probabilistic statement is still true in the large limit, there will be outliers. So you'll be completely fooled by that. All right, so this is not good. Spectral theory probably is not a good thing to rely on. By the way, this is the Wigner's semicircle law again. Okay, so now, what is really invariant? Well, if we think about it for probably 10 seconds, we can realize, wait a second. If we know that one matrix entry is larger than the other, no matter what monotonal linearity we apply, this relationship should stay preserved, right? So that much we know. So that's nice. So here is a natural question. Does the ordering of matrix entries, because this is what is really going on, so let's just look at the ordering of matrix entries, convey any information about the geometry? Because when you look at it, it's first, wait a second, you washed out a large swath of information right away. You just preserve the ordering. So what do I mean by geometry? Well, this is exact formulation. There exists a set of points in some Euclidean space. So here all the matrix is Euclidean, such that this relationship between matrix entries is this, say Cij is greater than CKL, if and only if the distances between these points satisfy the same order, right? So here is a nice question, and if you think about it, it's obvious if you should preserve any information about geometry. And of course, most of the geometry is washed out, but some information is readily preserved. And one of this, well, an example of this information is the bound on dimension. So here, okay, here I just arrange points on a line. Apologies, I never explained what these numbers mean. So this is the actual ordering of matrix entries. Remember, I told you what matters is the ordering of matrix entries, right? So this is this, zero is the smallest, one is the next smallest, two is third smallest, and so forth, right? So if I arranged points on a line, of course, we get this. So if I gave you this matrix with this ordering, if you think for a while, you would realize that maybe you can embed it into dimension two, but there is no way you can embed it in dimension one. Well, here, the reason is very simple, because these three consecutive smallest numbers meet one node of this directed graph, So if you think about it, you can't have three smallest distances on a line coming from the same node. So that's relatively simple. Okay, we can say something is not one-dimensional. That's easy. If I gave you this matrix, you would probably scratch your head. But given a fair amount of time, depending on your inclinations, you might actually prove that it's not two-dimensional anymore. That is, it's embedded in three dimensions, in at least three dimensions. The reason for this, okay, I will briefly explain that. This is this matrix enlarged over here. So the reason for this is this block of smallest entries. So if you think of the how orders of edges are arranged in your bipartite, you realize that this really forms a bipartite graph. So there is nodes 1, 2, 3, and nodes 4, 5. And the gem, okay, I will skip to why this is true. So if you think a little bit about what it means in terms of geometry of arranging on two-dimensional plane, this means that you could draw three circles of, say, radius 1. And there is a chord inside these three circles whose length is bigger than 1. And if you know a little bit about Euclidean geometry, you realize it's impossible. This is all cute, but there is. Okay, so okay, fine. These are six smallest edges, right? So which means that we can split our indices into two sets, 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, such that the distances between these two are the smallest, and the rest hang out here. Okay. So now the fact that these are the distances between the green points and the red points, right? So the red points are 1, 2, 3. The green points are 4, 5. Okay. So now the distance between this and that, all the six distances are the smallest. So let's assume they're just equal to 1. We can scale everything, right? Then the rest should be larger, including the green edge itself. And this is where the fallacy but this is where you get contradiction, because now what just happened? At the best case scenario, if you shrink them as much as possible, you get the radius 1 for the circles, but you can have a chord of length larger than 1. By the way, this argument, if you attempted to generalize this argument to dimension 3, you will fail miserably, because the appropriate spherical tetrahedron doesn't have this property. The chord has length larger than 1. It's called Rouleau tetrahedron. So if you are bored with the rest of my talk or seen it before, I really encourage you to find any property that would show up in dimension higher than 2. We actually failed. We played. But there is no general approach how to find abstractions in dimension higher than 2. All right. So as you can see, this is very special. And it looks like I'm driving myself into a big hole, because we can't really rely on these fine geometric things. That's just not going to work. So for what I'm going to describe next is a general machinery that still that can tell you the dimension, but can tell some, if some structure comes from Euclidean geometry or it comes from something else. And this is a slide that summarizes this machinery. So we start with the some symmetric matrix. We pass it through some topology machine, which I'm going to describe here. And we get something that we call Betti curves. And the basic ingredients are the following. First, you get an increasing filtration of graphs, which for some reason we call the order complex. Then you can compute click complexes, you compute Betti numbers, and thus you compute the Betti curves. And the last piece may be familiar to quite a few people in this room, but let me go slowly. So, and again, the reason for this machinery is that if you go through this machinery and get these curves, and you pass your original matrix through monotonal linearity, the result is exactly the same. Right, so this is a commutative diagram. So this is the whole point of doing this, that when you pass it, you get exactly the same result. All right, so let me start slowly. So how do we get increasing sequence of graphs? Well, for people who are used to quick thinking, if you just quotient symmetric matrices by Monotone increasing functions, it's exactly a filtration of graphs. But how does this work? Well, you just take your matrix. So take a vertex for each row of this matrix. So this is the largest entry in your matrix, put an h. Take the next largest entry in your matrix, put another h. So if you put enough edges, you get this graph. And each graph is a subgraph of the previous one. So you get increasing sequence of graphs. And it's rather inconvenient to deal with this thing. So there is, we introduce this parameter, which is just the density of edges, number of edges divided by inches two, right? Yeah?
Did we switch to undirected graphs?
This is undirected. So the matrix is symmetric. You caught me. So the entire talk, the rest of this talk will be about symmetric matrices, so undirected graphs. Because what I will talk about will be synonymous to correlation. It won't be correlation, but this comes from the same department. Okay, so all right. So now we got this increasing sequence of graphs, and we number this by edge density. So let me explain this. And there are many people in the audience who would recognize that this is just standard construction for Ripkes complex. Once you got your increasing sequence of graphs, you take it induces the increasing filtration of Clique complexes. But let me explain it for people who are not well familiar with this business. So again, this is how you get the graph. So this is your actual matrix. So as you increase the edge density, you get more edges. So now what we're gonna do, we fill in all the cliques in each graph. So here the cliques happen to be the triangles, right? So as we increase the edge density even more, this is not very clear. So what you are supposed to see in this picture is a sphere glued out of the triangles, okay? So, and here, what you notice is that there is one non-contractible loop. So we put BT1 equals zero. Here, this contractible loop got contracted because we live on a sphere, but we got non-contractible two-dimensional sphere. So you put BT2 equals to one. Apologies to topologists in the room. And once you filled enough edges, there are no non-contractible loops in any dimension. Oops, here, this is where it is cut off. But BTM is just the rank of the appropriate homology group. All right, so this is, of course, a cartoon. And again, the point of this construction is it's invariant under monotone transformations. So what happens in general, instead of Betti numbers, in this nice cartoon pictures, we get Betti numbers that depend on graph density. So for each dimension of Betti1, Betti2, and so forth, we get this curve. Well, this curve is actually, it's a lie because the values here are discrete, but nonetheless, this is a curve. And all right, so.
Sorry, what do you mean that it's invariant? Because if you change the function, don't those curves, don't you rescale?
No, not at all. Why? Because. Okay, if you change the function, these graphs, this increasing sequence of graphs stays the same.
Okay, so you always number the graphs by 1 to n. It has nothing to do with the scale in your matrix.
No. So each time I just added an edge, right? So how I added an edge doesn't depend on whatever monotonic function I chose.
Is n the same as the number of entries in the matrix and n squared?
M is the number of unique entries in the matrix. So because there may be repeated entries, so it's a bit more complicated. But yeah, so if you happen to have unique matrix, unique entries in the matrix is just n choose 2. All right. So can we tell a geometric organization from random? Because for what we know, we might end up with just whatever organization in the brain is just random. At least this is what seems to be true in the fly. So, okay. Ooh. Apologies. The last line got cut off, and this is the reference for some result I wanted to say. It's okay. I can say it in words. Doesn't matter. What it meant to say is, and the year I think was 2008. You can correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. So anyway. Let's just first look at random independently distributed matrices, right? Independently distributed matrices. So the appropriate graphs, of course, are the Schrödinger. And if we just draw this by T-curves, this is how they look. And here I have to explain in a little bit more detail what this really means. So you see this punctured line. This is the mean, because those are probabilistic quantities. So we can compute the expected value, or just the mean, by dropping our coins long enough. So this is the means, and these shaded regions are actually pretty much where the distribution is concentrated, up to some very low probability. And the as you see there, we have these nice bell shapes, and this reference I drew on the board by Matthew Cale is where first this boundaries of where the these bells become essentially zero were computed as n goes to infinity. All right, so so what? Now let's play a slightly different game. Now I'm going to describe what I mean by geometric matrices. So let's just take drop random points in Euclidean space. Well, by for the purpose of this talk, by Euclidean space, I will just mean Euclidean box. And let's compute Dij being Euclidean distances. And for purely technical reasons, I take it with negative sign. And let's play the same game. So what do these curves really depict? So again, this yellow, red, and blue is again Bt1, Bt2, Bt3. These numbers actually indicate the dimension of the space. That's this D, okay? And as you see, these curves actually stratified by dimension. By the way, this is a lie. Where I lied here is that this is actually means again. This is not the actual curves, but averaged over many trials. So the picture is a bit noisy if you draw just one, the beta curve from a random sample. And so far it looks so what? They look kind of similar. First thing you notice probably easily is that actually this increases and here the peaks decrease. That's the first difference. It sounds like a little bit like a kid's game, find n differences on the picture. But here is the most profound difference. Look at these numbers and look at that numbers. Oops, they're completely different order of magnitude actually. So this picture is a lie in a different way, that it's on different scale. So this is much smaller than this. Yeah?
So are there theorems to this effect?
What?
Are there theorems?
Okay, so there are theorems also due to Matthew Cale about where this bell-shaped things become essentially zero as n goes to infinity. To the best of, we talked to Matthew Cale, obviously, and he told us if he tries really hard, he can probably find an estimate on this peak, but it was not done yet. And when I asked him about the variance, because this, as you can imagine, for inferring dimension, you really want to know the variance of these things. That's completely wrong.
Those are dimensions?
Yeah, those are dimensions. There is a mysterious number 88. This is just n that happened to be the size of this matrix. It's apologies, it's not a very round number. Yeah, so those are dimensions that these things are depicted. Yeah.
So you keep the same
design for all? Yes, n is exactly the same. Thank you. N is 88 here. Well, it sounds like an arbitrary number. The reason why we chose n 88 is later I will show you some data that had n equals to 88. It's a random distance metric. So you see here, this PIJs, sorry, PI is NPJ are independent, But this matrix has a lot of correlation in this built in. If you think about it, you realize that there are lots of correlations among these different matrix entries. Like think triangle inequalities, right? So triangles inequalities alone impose a lot of correlation here, and that's just the beginning because they're also higher order analogs. So yeah. Yeah, these are just random, yes. So
uniform distribution within a rectangle.
Yes, so you can try, of course, different distributions, and the qualitatively the result is the same, the order of magnitude smaller. So and because there is no theoretical understanding of how the variance behaves, so I am abstaining from making any stronger statement. All right, any more questions? Yeah, so n is the number of entries.
How big for these calculations?
So for this picture, yeah, this is just n equals to 88. I'm thinking you ask, can I scale this computation? Is this correct? Or
it's pretty small.
Because if you say n equals to 1,000, you are kind of doomed. Because there is computational topology that is used here. And computing, it's not about computing homology at all, as a matter of fact. It's all about computing the click complex itself, where you get royally disadvantaged by going to large n.
For the uninitiated, how should I think of the edge density?
It's just the number of edges in the graph divided by inches two. I normalize it to be between 0 and 1. So probably I should just write it down, sorry. Oops. So rho equals to number of edges divided by inches two in the graph. So, and again, we could have all kinds of number of edges. Okay. So, okay, fine. So, if somebody presented us with a random matrix versus a matrix coming from random points in some Euclidean space, we could clearly tell the difference in many different ways. Great. So, natural question, can we tell this difference in an actual real data? Because we know there is a lot of noise in any kind of neural activity that happens in the brain, actually for two separate reasons. One reason is that the brain is intrinsically noisy, and another reason is that the data collection tools are equally iffy, so there are all kinds of issues with actual recordings. So, okay, let me give you a very concrete example. So, in what I'm gonna say next, there'll be some cells in rodent brain that actually get used. So let me explain what they are. So these are hippocampal place cells. Those are just cells in an area of a brain called hippocampus, and those are pyramidal cells for people who know a little bit of neuroscience. And what happens if I take a rat, I stick electrodes into hippocampus and let the rat roam around this room and take recordings, then let's say this square is the room and I record just one cell and I see in which part of the room it's active, I will notice this pattern. So it's active in some approximately convex part of the room. So if I record a different cell, it would be convex in a it will be active in a different convex region of the room. Record another cell, it will be, again, active in some relatively small region of the room, which, well, this doesn't look too convex to me, but approximately. And if we recorded too many of those, we could actually determine the position of the rat solely based on the neural firing. Well, let's think a little bit about this. So first, this is just one example. So there are many neural systems in mammalian brain that have similar properties, and more generally, these are called receptive fields. Now, if we just take this abstract picture and think for a moment, we can realize that if we recorded correlations between the cells, they should fall off with the distance between the centers of these fields, right? And well, and this should roughly depend on the overlaps on these fields. So this is just a simple probabilistic exercise, right? But we have no idea about what this G's should be, right? Fine. And now, what happens if we record the cells? Okay, this is all intuition, but does this actually work? So, and here is one caveat which I never explained. How do you even determine the correlation between different, say, between a pair of cells? Because the cells don't produce continuous signal. This is just spikes, right? So, nonetheless, you can compute correlation on physics lingo. It's called correlation function or cross correlogram, and now you can compute it on certain time scale and just average. So, and this is what we can use in lieu of this matrix Cij. So what it really means, it means that the cells are strongly or have strong or weak correlation on certain time scale. And the time scale actually matters. So this is this tau max. Okay. So what happens when we record the data and actually feed it to our topology machine? Well, first, I should say that this particular recording was done in where 88, this mysterious number 88 cells were recorded. So, and the rat was literally wandering two-dimensional large enough environment. So this is the beta curves that you actually get from the data. Well, so what? Well, of course, you need to compare it to something, right? So, our comparisons, well, shuffled is just another notion of random. You take upper diagonal elements, apply random permutation on n^2, right? So you get a random matrix. And there is a smarter way to do this. You can also preserve mean of row or column. So you can use maximal entropy distribution that preserves mean rows. Mean of each row. Well, this is symmetric matrix, so it's the same as column. And all right. So, and what does it look like? Well, if you compare it to this shuffle data, then you can see marked difference. So this is they are nowhere near each other. So not a big surprise here, because if you believe in place fields, you know it cannot be random. And if you compare it to geometric, then you see that this is kind of the same with some marked difference. So the peaks for the initiated, the peaks actually shift. So this is again stratified by dimension beta curves. Here you see, okay, there is a little bit of noise, but the peaks shift, and we think we understand why the peaks shift. If you add to this geometric data, just completely uncorrelated noise, that exactly results in shifting the peak, so that's not a big surprise. And now, because I will show this quite a lot in what follows, it's nice to summarize this data using this simple statistic. So this occurs, and it's always nicer to have just one number. So let's just integrate those across the edge densities, right? Let's just average. And all right, so let's call it beta m. And then the what you've seen in the previous pictures can be summarized in this nice plot. So this is beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. Now we just record just one number. From this beta curves, we integrate, we get one number. And these bars is the data. These little boxes are the distributions of appropriate beta numbers for the geometric regime. And we take dimension here always equals to number n. And these boxes are distributions for the shuffled or like more fancy version of shuffled random matrices. So they're clearly different from those, but completely consistent with geometric. So far, if you were neuroscientist, you would have an urge to leave the room because I proved you something you know already for the past 20 years. So of course there are place fields. Place cells. This is a well-known system, and you don't need any fancy math to see it. Why? Because you can record the cell activity. You can also record the position of the animal. You can correlate one to another. You infer place fields, and from that you infer everything else if you're sophisticated enough with basic math, right? But wait a second. I will tell you something neuroscientists did not know already. But before I go on, some reminder again. So again, if we believe in place fields, then the correlations behave in this manner, where xi's are some points, probably random in some Euclidean space, right? So question, do we detect geometric organization, or just something much simpler? Because being a skeptical person, when I saw this, my first reaction was, wait a second, these Betti curves are very highly refined derived object. It's not clear to me even if they capture any geometry whatsoever. Maybe all they do is capturing something much simpler. And one thing I know about, place cells and place fields, they encode position fairly well. And position is global synchronizing signal. Probably that's all that happens. And probably I should just leave the room now. But luckily, this is not the case. So this is, again, how real place fields look. By the way, they don't have to be convex. You could have, secondary peak. And now what neuroscientists believe is that, okay, if you have place cell, you have some function fi on two-dimensional plane, right? So x of t is the actual two-dimensional position of the animal. You feed position through this function, then add some noise, and this is what firing rate of the cell looks like. And this is the trajectory, right? Okay, so now, of course, we can take this model and, again, take the synthetic data. What we actually did was computing the real place fields and feed them through the synthetic data. Or we could do something a bit funky. Let's just still preserve global trajectory, but create artificial place fields where we scramble the convex geometry. Right. So what is this? If you were a child, you probably played games where you scramble pieces, square pieces on some board. So this is what happened here, just random permutation applied to that. And let's take each real place field and scramble it in this way. And again, feed through this scrambled function the true trajectory. So we have two synthetic data sets. One is roughly real. Well, it's already a bit more refined than the real data set, but it still preserves the basic statistical features. And the other is this. So if we believe that this business of Betti curves is a reflection of something much simpler, like global signal, then we should see it also on this data set, right? So, well, no surprises on this slide. So if we take this data set with, again, where we generated it, where we generated the firing rates according to this place field, we get, again, very similar picture. You've seen it already. No surprises here. But if you do it with the scrambled place field, something very different happens. So again, they're highly non-random. This is a comparison to the random matrices. Of course, these are not random. And here, this is the first place where Betti 1 versus Betti 2 and Betti 3 start playing out. So here, somehow, Betti 1 is still consistent with geometric, but Betti 2 and Betti 3 are highly non-geometric. So these lower curves are the standard geometric curves I showed. And these guys shoot up well outside the geometric regime. So it's kind of weird. So Betti 1 is still consistent, but for some reason, the higher Bettis are not. And actually, we don't have a good explanation for that. We have some wild guesses, but we don't know exactly what goes on. And again, these pictures can be nicely summarized in this bar plots. So again, here, no surprises. The data is straight in the geometric regime. And for this model, relative to the geometric regime, Betti 2 and Betti 3 are outside, but Betti 1 is still in the geometric regime. And again, these are pretty much outliers as far as random matrices are concerned. So they're still highly non-random. it should not be surprising because they're synchronized by global trajectory. Yeah?
Yeah, so what like procedure do you use to do the scrambling, and how robust is this result to different scramblings?
Okay, so here the scrambling is literally, okay, probably I should go a few, oh, this is a good slide, yeah. So let's take this and simply permute this smaller squares. Random permutation, this is how we do it. And you do it independently for each cell. That's very important. Otherwise, you haven't changed anything. And the funny thing, if you use your favorite Bayesian inference gadget, you could still infer trajectory from large enough number of cells. So the spatial information is still preserved. It's just the geometry of the how the cell's fires is destroyed. Right, so your question, how robust it is to scrambling? So if I repeat it, of course I get the same picture, so that's very robust. So probably a more sort of the better question, what happens if I enlarge sizes of the squares? And you got me here. If I the squares become larger, like say quarter of this thing, then they will get close to geometric, as you can imagine, because some geometry will be preserved. Right, so did I answer your question? Yeah. Okay. Oh, I'm a bit too fast. Okay. So, what conclusion do we draw from this exercise? It's that indeed, what Betti curves are measuring, in particular this even more refined object, is the geometry, not just the global, that they're all synchronized to global signal. So there is something geometric about it. And again, we are still hard-pressed to understand why Betti 1 is consistent, but these guys are completely off the charts. Yeah?
These geometric confidence intervals,
yeah.
Are they calibrated for two dimensions,
or? They're actually calibrated for n equals to a number of nodes, always. We decided that there is a deeper reason for this, actually. The deeper reason for this is that there is a simple lemma one can prove that if somebody hands you another complex, that is the symmetric matrix with distinct entries is important, actually, then you can always embed in the sense of the slides in the very beginning of the talk, this order complex into d equals to n minus 2. But this embedding is highly non-generic. So if you were, this is the reason why even, this is the reason why random matrices look nothing like geometric. Because you can handpick the embedding in d equals to n minus 2, always. But that would be highly non-generic, so any independence will be out of the window. It will be highly contrived. So in particular, the independence of the points is important in this business, actually. Okay, so now I hope I convince you that I indeed measure something about the geometry. And of course, in hippocampus, it's kind of cheating because we measure the position. We could measure the receptive fields, that is the place fields. We did not need any of this math you've seen. But what happens in the context where you don't even know the stimulus? Maybe you record in some other brain area, or just even in hippocampus when the spatial position is not relevant. Could you see it? So, and now let's just define this as a property and call it a hypothesis, because you would still have to prove it in each particular case. So here is a question. What happens in the absence of spatially structured stimuli? And it's not clear if the neurons should do anything like what you've seen. And for more neuroscience inclined people, here is a more down to the point question. Is this structure inherited from sensory inputs? Because maybe all hippocampus is doing, okay, the rat walks around the room, you see your spatial environment, then all these brain regions preprocess this information, nicely package it, and pass down to hippocampus where it's already spatially structured, surprise, surprise. Or is it just a structure of the network itself? So for this, we used another neuroscience data set. So one is just the rat happily running in the running wheel, doing nothing else, just spacing out. And another is the animal sleeping. And in this situation, it's questionable whether there is some spatial information is relevant here. But here, unless you dream strictly of two-dimensional environments, which the rats might do, I actually don't know. It's questionable whether there is any spatially structured inputs from sensory system. And this is the long story presented short. So the answer to both questions about whether they're geometric or not is that resoundingly yes. So both for the wheel running and for the REM sleep, we found that we tried many data sets. These are just different data sets that were all geometric. One exception actually was one REM sleep data set. So because my story sounds almost too pretty. So here is a caveat. Out of four data sets we tried, one sleeping data set wasn't geometric. So the story is not as cute as I tried to present. But nonetheless, so, and the mini conclusion from here, okay, probably it's the property of the circuit. Well, it may be not property of hippocampus, though, because it still receives inputs from many brain areas, but at least the inputs from the other brain areas are already spatially structured, even though there is no apparent spatially structured stimulus, because the rat is just sleeping. All right. And of course, if you're into asking finer neuroscience questions, you could wait. You could have caught my hand. Wait a second. You were just talking about one time scale. By the way, this entire series of pictures you've seen were for tau equals to 1 second. Tau max is this the time scale of cross correlation, right? So what happens on other time scales? So we try to look into this as well. So and. Here, this is just a statistical summary. So black is spatial navigation, green is wheel running, and red is REM sleep. And here, the lower this curve is, the more geometric it is. The higher, the less geometric it is. And what is x-axis? This is the time scale, and it's actually reverse. So this is 2 seconds, 1 second, and here it goes to finer and finer time scales. And this is a bit controversial. So some people throw tomatoes into us but about this picture. But nonetheless, what we find is that for at least in the spatial navigation, it's pretty consistent across the time scales. But for the other two behaviors, it's not the case. So it stops being geometric defined at the time scale you set. And I will abstain from making any statement about this part, but just for reference, if some people know, this is the period of theta oscillation, and this is where things start breaking down. We are not sure, actually. So we have a lot of internal debates whether it is an artifact. The data is still massive because here is what this time scale is just the size of temporal window you slide over your massive data set, right? So it's a bit more complicated than, but it, there is a chance it could be an artifact of how the data is collected, because
in this case, is why the black curve is different from the others?
We don't know. Short answer: we are only 50% sure this is real, which is really bad, of course. So I would not put. But there is a chance it's real. If it is real, then that's kind of something to pause, because. Yes, and there is because this is period of theta oscillation, and there is a vast literature on theta oscillation, how it helps with spatial navigation. But I can't go into this with any detail. So, but the crazy thing, you also see oscillations on theta scale in the other two behaviors. In fact, this is how we selected the other two data sets. We also want them to have a solitary behavior so that they're maximally similar to each other. But somehow the result is different. So, there is quite a literature that explains or misexplains on how fit oscillation helps with the place fields to operate normally. Okay, I'm actually getting close to the end. So what did we learn from my talk? We ask one question: what can we learn from correlation structure of neural activity and how? And there are two answers. One is for mathematician. It's possible to use topological tools to detect a geometric organization hidden by unlinear but monotone transformation. And another answer is more neurosensory oriented. Actually, we think we, at least at large enough timescales, we discovered that the activity in hippocampus is spatially structured regardless of whether you're engaged in any kind of spatial navigation or not, even during sleep. So probably this geometric organization is a property of a circuit, which is kind of fun. And a mathematical aside, we can't say anything about dimension because there need to be a lot more theorems proven about geometric distributions to even put a probability on the estimate for dimension. That's an unfortunate truth. And that's it. So thanks to finding agencies. And the people who were involved with this work is Chad Giusti, who is sitting on the second row, and also Karina Kurta and Penn State, and Eva Pastalkova, whose data we used and who is now at HHMI. That's it.